Yo, what up, what up, what up? Peace, everybody out there, internet world. What's really good? It's your guy, it's the coach. It's your boy, your favorite, the host of the Coach's Corner on Konnected TV. This is Coach Terry 803. Please follow me on all social media platforms. I'll make sure I give you a follow right back. That's how we do it. Each one teach one, show love. I show love, you show love. I shine, you shine. We all shine. Yo, what's good? This is episode number 7, yes, that Michael Vick, John Elway number, the universal number 7. Oh, man, it's beautiful to be back in the corner. I know it's been a minute. I know it. Listen, coach got a lot going on, man. Basketball season was crazy. I was, you know, coaching in my middle school, man, kind of just fell into that and still doing the PA for Allen University. So my schedule was just, it was crazy, y'all. It was crazy. Then we jumped right into track season. And that's full swing now, but I had to make sure I take some time out, drop this new episode, changing up the format a little bit for 2024. But first of all, you know what to do. Go ahead and click subscribe to the channel. Make sure that you hit that notification bell so every time something drop, you get that notification. First and foremost, you can come and check it out. Tell a friend to tell a friend to tell a friend to tell somebody to share it, to repost it, to like it, to comment, all that good stuff. You heard? Also, comments, drop them right there on the video, or you can email me at kkonktv@gmail.com. That's just Coach's Corner or KonnectedTV@gmail.com. Abbreviated, shortened it. You know what I'm saying? Also, please, please, please make sure you get out that Fire Stick remote and download the Konnected TV app. Always look up because I have a TV up on the wall in the Coach's Corner. Install that Konnected TV app. So you can take the Konnected TV with you wherever you go. You can watch the Coach's Corner plus a lot of other dope content we have dropping on the Konnected TV app almost on a daily basis. So make sure you're doing that, supporting black business, supporting small business, supporting entrepreneurs, all that good stuff. Yeah, you know I mean? Yo, so it's 2024. Got a lot to talk about. This week, that beat that you heard as I was coming in, shout out to my boy DL Wood. Cat from Alabama, man, dropped me this beat. Rocking the shirt, Metro Commandos, my AAU program. We're going to dig into a little bit more of the Metro Commandos travel ball / AAU program. In this episode, we're going to take you behind the scenes of some tryouts, talk to my coaches, interviews, and all that good stuff. That's why I say this. So I had to kind of take time off a little bit and let this joint bake, let it simmer, let it marinate. All right, give you some fresh content for 2024, changing up the format, doing things a little bit differently just to give you some spice because I listen to the feedback. My ears are always open, y'all. You give me feedback, good or bad, I take it in, I absorb it, I rub it into the skin, smack it up, flip it, rub it down. Oh, no. Oh, yes. I'm creating a better show for you because after all, this is the people's show. Can you smell it with the coach? It's cooking. You heard me? All right, man. Listen, I ain't going to sit there. I ain't going to take too long with this. Oh, also, shout out to my man Fareed for the hat. I am Energy. Make sure you go check him out. I'm going to drop the IG right up here. Boom. Make sure you check him out. I am Energy Sports. Got some gear, obviously hats. He's got other apparel, some sneakers, and other things like that. So check him out, man. Doing big things. Another cat that I knew from back home. Buffalo, we used to hoop together, hoop against each other, all that good stuff. But also very talented singer and obviously entrepreneur. So like I say, man, if you have promotional material, you have product you want me to plug on the show, please hit me up, kkonktv@gmail.com. I'll give you my address, you know what I'm saying? You send it to me, I'll pay for it. I want to support you. So I'll pay for your product and I'll still plug it on the show. All right, that's how real I keep it. That's how funky I keep it. You dig? Everybody ain't like that, but I ain't like everybody. So it is what it is, because you know what it is. This is the Coach's Corner. This is your intersection of sports, social commentary, and special interests, leaning neither left nor right, walking straight down the middle to help you solve that riddle called life. This is the Coach's Corner. We on Konnected TV. We on YouTube. Sit back. Get yourself some cold to drink, because this is going to be a good one. DL Wood, take us out, man. You gotta make the ugly face when you hear that piano, man. I'm a sucker for pianos, man. If you have a beat with a piano in it, I'm gonna love it. Like, that's just, I don't know, that sound, that instrument does something to my ears. We're gonna talk about music. I've talked about, if you go back to past episodes, we did the Billboard Top 50 and what I thought about it. That was over the summer, like episode 2 or 3, when we were just kicking this thing off. Anyway, yeah, we're gonna jump right into it. This is the segment. We talking about AAU life here, and I know, look, that's been a hot button topic for a long time in sports circles, whether you're a parent, whether you're a player, whether you're just a fan of the sport, or even just a casual person, you know, just who keeps up with what's going on in the world. And I fell into it, actually. This is my 9th year in it, and I fell into it when I moved to Columbia in 2012. I was coaching rec ball, and then one day I was sharing a gym with another rec ball coach. Or actually, he was doing some training down on the other end, and you know, he saw how I was coaching and interacting with the kids, and so he asked me, did I want to come in and help him train some kids? Coach Jay, shout out to Coach Jay, by the way. So yeah, a lot of people know who Coach Jay is. He's currently the B team coach at Spring Valley High School here in Columbia. So Coach Jay, I started training with Coach Jay, and then my homeboy, Rashad, calling my brother, shout out to you, those IG up there, go follow my guy. His son was playing at the time for another AAU program. So we came together one day, we were sitting around, this is actually after I first got married, we were sitting around kind of celebrating that with him and his wife, and just having some wine, eating dinner, and talking, and he's like, yo man, we can kind of link up and do our own thing, man, put this thing together and do things, you know, the way we feel like it should be done, the right way, again, according to how we feel things should be done. I was like, all right man, I really didn't know the first thing about it, right? So I was like, all right, let's go ahead, let's do it, I'm with you. So he said, okay, I'll take Marco, that was his son, DeMarco Johnson, shout out to him, one of the top players in the class of 2025, out of Southern California. I'll get to that in a second. So anyway, so he get the program started. He's coaching his son DeMarco's team. They're playing fifth grade ball, but most of them were in fourth grade. They have some fourth and fifth graders. If you know anything about travel ball, you have to play up. So if you have kids that are in fifth grade and some are in fourth, but on the same team, they have to play up to that fifth grade level. All right, so that's just how it is. So they were doing that. I was coaching the 8th grade team, but most of them were actually 7th graders. We only had 2 8th graders. And how we did that was a bunch of kids that I was training, some kids that I coached in rec league, I just, you know, we made some flyers, sent them joints out with the kids. They got back to us. We had a team. We was rocking and rolling, all right? So that was our first year, 2016. Just trying to figure this thing out, man, and, you know, getting our teeth kicked in, you know what I'm saying, to keep it all the way funky with y'all. But we were trying to figure it out. Like I said, he had mostly 4th graders playing a 5th grade ball. I had mostly 7th graders playing a 8th grade ball. Kids we just had training from the gyms and rec teams. So we had to get used to that level of competition, because travel ball slash AAU is a step up in competition from the rec league. Matter of fact, we ended up adopting that saying, like, this ain't rec league. We would always tell people that, because you'll get kids that will come and they will be all-stars in rec league, but they get the AAU and it's, you know, they kind of struggle until they get used to it. Some don't ever get used to it, and they never achieve that level of success they had playing rec ball. But we tell them all the time, this ain't rec league. Anyhow, all right, so back to the story, the Commandos. So we did that. So then what happened is his wife got a great opportunity in Los Angeles area, Southern California. And so, you know, obviously, as you said, it was a great opportunity. It's one of you can't pass that up. So the whole family moved out to California, and you know, like I said, he was running the program. I was just coaching. And so, okay, that's the end of the Commandos. I was coaching Pop Warner at the time. I think I just, yeah, that was my first year I went to middle school. I was coaching over there at Dent Middle football. And so I'm like, well, I'm good. I'm still coaching football to middle school. And that's just going to be it. Bunch of the kids, coach, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? You're going to keep the Commandos going. We know Coach Johnson moving. What you gonna do? I'm like, look, man, I don't know the first thing about running this program. But that year, my family went to LA and spent Christmas. We spent like a week or so with you know, Rashad and his family and all of them out there in L.A. As once they got settled in, we went out there Christmas time, spent about a week or so out there. My first time in California. It was great. We fell in love with L.A., whole family. And so he put me on. He said, listen, bro, you can do this. Like, he gave me the sauce, everything I need to do as far as getting uniforms ordered, gym. Like, he gave me the blueprint. Was like, look, just do this. Put your own touch on it and keep it moving, bro. I'm like, all right. So I did. That next year, I split up. I took that team that I was coaching, the 7th to 8th graders. The 8th graders moved up to 9th grade, found some more 9th grade cats, filled that team up. Then the guys who were 7th playing up, you know, they went to 8th, so I just kept them there, filled that team up. So we had two teams that year and was rocking in. Then the next year, went to 3 teams because we had so many 9th graders. I had 2 9th grade teams plus a 10th grade team. Then we started a younger Commandos. We call them the Young Soldiers Program. So we started those guys at 4th grade. But again, we kind of had that mix. A lot of them were 3rd grade, 4th grade. So we had them. That's actually the class of 2026. That would be them. Actually, 25. I don't even know. So over the course of the years, man, you know, I'll just say, you know, we graduated the class of 2020. That was that first team that I had as 8th graders. Took them all the way through 2021, 22, 23. So we graduated 4 classes of kids. Most of them we had in the program from 7th grade, 8th grade, through high school. 23s was a little bit different. We just started them in 10th grade and took them through, you know, 10th, 11th, 12th grade. You know, and over that time, man, you know, I could sit here and talk all day about my experiences, highs, lows, ups and downs, you know, headaches and things like that, being a program director. But, you know, it's just, see, giving these guys the opportunity is really what it's about. And one of the things that I know when I was coming up, I always wanted to be part of something like that, but I could never afford it. Like, my mom didn't have the money and things like that, and just trying to travel. A lot of things logistically just didn't work out for me. So, you know, once I got this opportunity, I said one of the things I always want to do, number one, is make it affordable. Number two, give guys the opportunity that may be overlooked. Because, you know, it's easy to go out and pick out, you know, the best guys and bring them in and create a team and, you know, run and have success with it. But I don't mind the building process. Like, I don't mind bringing in marginal guys, bringing in guys that are overlooked, bringing in guys that are, quote unquote, slept on and training and building them up. And we go out there and we actually win and compete against some of these other top teams. And, you know, over the course of years, we've gotten our asses kicked. I mean, I ain't going to sugarcoat that. I don't think anybody who playing travel ball will tell you that they've gotten their brains beaten in several times. If you say you haven't, then all right, then maybe you just got all 5 stars on your team and that never happens to you. But I know some really good teams and I've seen scores like, wow. So it happens, man. It is what it is. Another team and pick up kids from around the area, train them, coach them. We go out and we play regionally. But we was playing Combine Academy. And I'm talking about, you know, like, it's a 6-point game. We actually had a lead at one point. So they looking at us like, who are these cats? And we playing as college coaches out there. We performing well. Yo, this kid gave us 41 on the other team. And, I mean, it's nothing you can do. You can say, coach, come on. Why didn't you try to trap him at half court, take the ball out of his hands? Why didn't you throw doubles at him? Like, man, we tried all of that. He was just shooting from further and further back. Yo, that kid was on fire. And sometimes there's nothing you can do in that situation. We end up losing to them by like 8. But at the end of the game, you know, we gained a lot of respect from a lot of people because, again, we're just a regular team, yo. Like, you know, people look at us and they overlook us. And that's fine. I don't mind that because I've always been overlooked my whole life. And so I carry that chip on my shoulder, that mentality throughout my program with the coaches that I bring into the program and all the players that we've had, like I said, in the last 8 years. Probably I counted the other day, I counted all of our players. We've had something like over 250 players on our roster. We've sent a lot of players to college ball. And we've had, gosh, I counted, I think it was like 32 teams. So, I mean, a lot, like I said, a lot of programs that started when we started no longer around and have been gone. Programs that were around when we started aren't here anymore. We're still here. We're still standing. But anyway, like I said, I can talk all day about this because it's something that I'm passionate about. It's something that I put a lot of time, money, and effort into, and I don't get anything back from this. Like, we are a nonprofit. I registered us as a nonprofit organization. I don't get any money from this. Matter of fact, I spend money every year, thousands of dollars into this. My coaches don't get paid. They volunteer their time. We take these boys out of town. We treat them like our own. We spend our money on them. We love on them. We teach them things. You know, as young men, we try to develop them as players and as men. And, you know, frankly, that's the reward. That's the payback we get from them. Sure, we get trophies and medals and things like that. But, you know, I've got a whole bunch of them here in the coach's corner, in my man cave, and they just collect dust. And, you know, it's nice to look at sometimes, but ultimately, it's about the relationships with my guys, the 2020 and 2021 guys who graduate and are grown. You know, when they invite me to their games, sometimes obviously can't come, but when I see them play, or even the ones who didn't play on another level, who just grown men now, college students, you know, texting me about their scores and their grades, and you know, guys sending me, you know, invites to their what they have, those gender reveals and stuff like that. Just wanting to keep in touch and letting us know how they're doing, man. It's that's the reward in itself, man. And I know, look, I know it doesn't make sense. I don't quite understand it myself, because year after year I tell myself, I'm not doing this again. It's too much of a headache. They get on my nerves. They don't appreciate nothing. These kids too entitled, you know, but it's like I said, the chance to, you know, when I hear these kids say, man, I've never been there before. And they get excited when we go places like to Atlanta, or we went to Tennessee on the charter bus, or, you know, when we go to Myrtle Beach, Charleston, you know, different places like that. When they go to North Carolina, like, it's just giving those experiences and things, they're forming bonds and brotherhoods with guys that they may never have met before, because they go to different schools, live in different parts of the town. And that's the part about it, man, that keeps us all going. You know, shout out to all the parents, players, coaches that have had over the years that have dedicated themselves to the Metro Commandos program. You know, we can't do any of this without you. Since this is our ninth year running it, man, and just looking forward to a good season. I'm going to go ahead and stop talking finally now, and I'm going to let you check out some footage from a couple different tryouts that we had. Always looking for new players. Of course, returning players are always welcome, as long as you keep improving your game. And here's some interviews from our coaches. So, again, sit back, check out this footage. I know you're going to enjoy it. Hopefully you learn something, too. Maybe I can sway you towards forming a positive opinion of AU travel ball. Again, there's different levels to it. Again, we're talking about the grassroots, foundational, local level. You know, we're not talking about payola and all the other stuff that comes into play. But again, sit back, check out a day, or I'm going to say a day, some days in the life of the Metro Commandos. You see my jersey up there. Sitting in here with Coach Hildebrand of the Metro Commandos and many other schools that he's worked at over the years. Coach H, how you doing this evening?
Man, I'm doing all right, man. I'm here.
Why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself and give the people a little bit about your background.
All right. Hey, he said it already. I'm Coach Hildebrand. And let's see. Whatever you need. Hey, let's say high school. A number one high school in Columbia, AC Floor. Went to AC Floor. After that, University of Wisconsin. After Wisconsin, East Tennessee State, played overseas. Hey, that's it. That's it. Pretty much it.
Who better to represent the program than Coach Carl Wilson, not only a longtime coach in the program, but also the vice president. Coach Wilson, thanks for joining us in the corner. I'm sitting here with Coach Evan Goodyear of the Metro Commandos program. I'm going to ask him a few questions about his involvement in AAU / travel basketball. Coach Evan, thanks for joining me on the Coach's Corner. You've been with the program pretty much since the first year, and you've seen it grow. You've coached a lot of winning teams yourself in the program. With 2021, you guys actually brought home our first championship when you had them as eighth graders, our first tournament of the year.
Back a while. I started some years ago when I was in New Jersey. I did girls, coached girls basketball, AAU basketball, and did that for a year and a half, and you know, was out of it for a minute. Had the opportunity to join you with the Commandos, and been with the the Commandos for 3 years. So this right here will be my fourth year going in.
Experience. How long were you in it as a both a player and a coach?
So I've been involved in AAU since sixth grade, specifically the Commandos since ninth grade, and I've been involved in coaching since my sixth year coaching.
I got involved in AAU because I started at the rec level, and I was coaching rec, and I ended up and I was coaching Talon, who is your son, and you know, seeing you and you had a team. You invited me out, came out, coached your, I think y'all was there in your second year, because that was the ninth grade team. You had a seventh and eighth, then the eighth grade and the ninth grade. So I coached the ninth grade team and been coaching ever since. Been with the Commandos ever since. So that's about 7 years now, 8 years.
So some of the advantages I think that come from AAU are a lot of kids with the opportunity to expose themselves that they might not have been exposed in high school. I think high school and AAU are like night and day. So we might have a team that's riding upon it in high school and may not have the opportunity to show what he can do in high school, but he can do that in AAU. And you know, AAU, you got college coaches watching you every tournament. You got coaches that are really investing. You know, high school, these guys are getting paid to coach you, so they can, you know, they're going to have new guys come in every year. But AAU, you got coaches that aren't getting paid. They're here just for your well-being. You got coaches that care about you. That's what I think the advantages are for AAU.
The coach, as your son Carl, has been in an organization just as long as you have. What do you think some of the benefits are of kids playing AAU?
Well, one benefit of kids still playing AAU is they stay on the court. They're always playing. And you're always trying to develop the kids. You know, we always having workouts, you know, once a month. So we always trying to get development in so the kids always stay on the court and they don't lose any of those fundamentals that from playing high school. Because, you know, these kids in this generation get kind of lazy. Not all kids. But, you know, some kids get lazy. So once the basketball season is over with, they're not doing anything. But the benefit of playing AAU ball, you stay in competition. You start seeing players that's a little bit better than you. So that makes you work harder. So when time for you to get back up into your high school, you know, you done got a little bit better because you haven't just sat down the rest of the year after finishing your high school ball.
In your vast experience as a high school, middle school, and AAU coach at all levels, what do you think some of the benefits are of players participating in travel ball?
Well, the main thing, and it's all changed. The game has changed and recruiting. I mean, there's more recruiting in AAU ball than in high school ball. So that's one of the biggest benefits that playing AAU ball, travel ball, can be for the athlete.
A parent and as a coach, parent, yep.
And as a coach, you know, more so as a parent. The benefit is life lessons that we learn in playing sports. What they see other men volunteering their time, because AAU, we don't get paid, you know. So they see other men volunteering their time, spending time with kids that aren't even theirs. And that gives them, you know, a positive role model, you know. And so, and then with our program, we teach not just winning, but competing.
Yep.
And finishing what you start and giving it 100%, regardless of winning, all the chips ain't, you know, in our corner. So I think the biggest lesson or the biggest advantage to AAU or the, is those life lessons.
Right now, my biggest thing is there's no loyalty. There's no loyalty in it. I mean, they'll hop around to whoever offering them whatever. We're going to this city. We're going to this city. There's no loyalty. And there's... You know, that's a downside. You know, you're trying, got a group of guys playing, and they may want to play over here one weekend, play over here the next weekend, but there's no consistency. And with that right there, you know, I mean, like I said, it's a big recruiting thing, so they're trying to get them out there. Now, on the coach's side, egos get in. These egos, you know, some of these coaches, you know, it's not about the player. It's about their ego, who they have on their team, who they, you know, who what tournament they playing in and all that. They could care less about the development of the player.
The parents have to know that when, you know, there's different levels of this thing. There's, you know, you got AAU, you got just the beginners of AAU, you got the AAU, the circuit, you know, then you got, you know, you got your high school teams, then you got your college levels, then you got the NBA. You know, it's the same thing, you know, with the AAU, because you start meeting some of these teams and, you know, you're not going to be ready yet. It's a longevity thing. It's 4 years. So, you know, or 7 years, depending when you start, you know, you got to just stay with it, keep grinding, keep groups together. And me saying that because, you know, it's a lot of teams out there, you know, that have, I ain't gonna necessarily say egos. They want to win. They rather win than teach. So I'm going to go and grab all these players, this best player, this good player off this team. I'm going to make this one team, and then we just going to go to these tournaments and just beat people heads in. But you never see those same teams that they just put together go and play the big teams. They'd rather stay here and just show, okay, well, I'm just beating up on all these teams right here. But you don't go and play anybody. You know, and that's one thing that we have done here. We have tried to step our game up every year. Every year we try to step up. Of course, we may not be able to compete with some of the bigger teams. I mean, I'm not going to say that we can. You know what I'm saying? But the teams that we play year in and year out now, we can compete.
Some of the negatives that I think have made you, I know I just said how well you can expose yourself at AAU, but I think in this, today's modern era, I think AAU is kind of taught kids the wrong kind of way to play basketball in some sense. You know, they think it's all one-on-one and trying to score, and really, that's just a small part of the game. So I think today's AAU, while it is helpful and they can get your name out there, I think that, you know, some of these kids these days aren't learning to play the game the right way.
Yeah, I probably shouldn't say this. You're probably going to have to edit it a lot. But you know, basketball is a competitive sport, right? We say basketball, it is a contact sport. You know, it's not football, it's not rugby, but it is a contact sport. There's no grass that you fall on. You fall on hard, you fall on hardwood. So whenever you got, my second best memory is whenever you got your five players on the court and it's going to happen. Somebody's going to get fouled hard. And the game get chippy. And the refs ain't doing their job to control it. We as adults and as coaches, a lot of times we have to set the example and hold our composure. So when I'm watching a game and I see one of my players get fouled hard on purpose, and I see those other four kids step up, help him up, stand in between him and the other guy, other team, that's one of my fondest memories, one of them, because that lets me know that the team buy into what we're saying, which is always, we all we got, and we're family, especially when we travel. So that's another one. Even though, you know, we teach good sportsmanship, but as men, we know at some point, you gotta stand up for yourself. And if you can't do that, especially on the basketball court, you know, you're gonna get ran over. And in the beginning, that's what it was. You know, I know you remember the times we had aggressive training with Coach G.
Coach G.
Trying to see why is our kids won't fight. So when we see it, it's like, okay, now you see what we're saying.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Well, a couple memories that are famous in mind from playing AAU. The first one had to be when I broke the three-point record in terms of I had just got done playing a game on my team, and Coach Sarah just come with a throw jersey on and come in, and I just hit like 6 threes in a row.
Yeah.
So that was fun.
He was on fire.
And then, this is kind of a negative, but it was a wholesome moment. We had a tournament, I think it was in like the Augusta or something like that, and I think I got fouled really hard, and the guy like broke me. And I remember like three or four of my teammates, and this is my first year of the program, they ran in there and like almost started to fight. While I don't promote violence or anything, it felt good knowing that these guys that barely knew me had my back. And that's really why I stayed with the Commandos, because I knew like these guys had my back no matter what. So yeah, those are a couple of my favorite moments from the Commandos.
So Coach H, being that your 2023 Commandos in their 3 years with the program ended up being the winningest team in program history in terms of championships won and also championship games played in. Can you share some of your favorite memories that you've had in your three going on 4 years with the organization?
Well, you know what? When I first started and the team that I had, hey, the players were hungry. We were hungry. We were one of the hungriest teams in the organization. So I said, boy, we can stick together. Now, we used to always play Friday, Saturday. Couldn't get to Sunday. Sunday was championship. Couldn't get there. The following year, we got closer. We would get to the championship, but we would lose. This past year, when they were seniors, oh, nah. The whole weekend was ours. The whole weekend was ours. Now, we playing, when we play on Friday, we know we're going to get there on Sunday and win the whole thing. Oh, this right here, when we went to Charlotte, a team full, 12 players. You know what we had? Five players. They were all in my car when we went to Charlotte. We were playing top teams the whole weekend. We won it all with five players. We won it all. We won the whole thing. Now, the most memorable thing that I enjoyed, all these guys that we had, the senior year, hey, getting them into college. Well, they got themselves in college. We just put them in the right position. We had guys to go into college. That's what it's all about. That's what this AAU is all about. Developing, getting these kids where they can be seen, and all they got to do is what they do, play ball. Bam. In everybody that needs players, hey, there you go. You want to be one of these players that's going to get recruited and get to school. Commandos, baby.
Is there any advice that you have to young coaches out there looking to get into the game?
Well, like I said, I've been doing this for a long time. When I say a long time, I've been in the game. I've been playing this thing for a long time. So only thing that I can say is just keep pushing. Now, if you're young in this, hey, don't get discouraged. All you got to do is keep pushing. There's a lot of young cats out here now, you know, they're making their name. And when I say making their name, they're making their name by coaching these kids, you know, not just by throwing the ball out, rolling the ball out, let them go. You know, a lot of that's going on, a lot. And when I say a lot is going on. But, hey, just be persistent. Keep on. It's going to work out for you. As long as you have one thing in mind, it's not about you. It's about the athlete. It's about that basketball player. It's a lot. There's so many schools out there. Hey, if you helping this child, this athlete, get to one of those schools, your job is complete. Just continue doing that. It's not about you. It's about your players. Keep pushing. Commando, baby.
Advice that you have to any young coaches that want to get into AAU or any young players before they jump into AAU?
Yeah, it's good. You know, come in, you know, get into AAU, play, but keep an open mind. You know, understand that there's going to be one kid better than you. So that means that you have to work hard. As a coach, there's going to be some coaches that's going to out-coach you. not necessarily have better players than you, but they will out-coach you. So start learning. Learn from your mistakes and grow. That's what I did. I learned from my mistakes, and I just kept growing, you know.
Because of your contributions to the program over the years, bringing in a number of kids, Coach Wilson was just talking about it, how mm-hmm. because of that first year with the fourth grade team, you brought half of those kids in from your rec team. Every year you bring kids to the program, you know, so we wanted to make sure that you were given a proper due.
Top recruiter.
That's true. But what is it that you look for in players that you want to bring to the organization?
You know, how kind of two things. I look at how involved parents are, because, you know, with AAU, we don't have somebody behind our back like a school giving us money out of the pot, right? So that support is big. And how well they, you know, how well they listen to me, you know, in other words, respect, you know, like I'm not a player, you know, I don't have a resume that says I played in the NBA or anything like that, or college ball. So for a kid to give you their undivided attention, it says a lot about respect. For the older kids, what I look for is, you know, how we always preach, you know, you don't get better just by coming to practice. It's what you do outside.
Yes, sir.
So I look at how much they do individually. How much they tell me if they're out in the driveway practicing. So I look for that commitment to the game and that level of respect. Whenever I think about a kid coming to the program.
Coach Wilson, with you not only being a coach in the program, but also the vice president of the organization, how do you handle both of those roles, and how do you find yourself separating those roles when it comes to not only practices, but tournaments and dealing with parents and everything else that comes with it?
Well, coaching is the heart, because, you know, I get out there and like my kids, when I tell them, like, when I step on the court, I'm ready. You know, just like we have, you know, in our rules that when they come in the gym, they got to have their laces tied, you know, because you should be ready, you know, as you know, man. But, you know, when I'm coaching, my focus is on the kids and what they need, you know, and once we get in the gym, that's all I'm dealing with.
Thank you, Jackson.
All right, hold on.
Go. You ain't know.
All right, I ain't gonna hold y'all too long. So this next segment right here, I'm going to give you a glimpse of what it's like to be me for a weekend. Not only am I the official athletics announcer for Allen University, I'm also the official PA announcer for the Metro City Classic. What is the Metro City Classic, you ask? Good question, my friend. The Metro City Classic is only the premier showcase for middle school hoops in the Carolinas. I'm talking about North and South. It's right here in Columbia. It's the 10th year of the event. This year was titled A Decade of Dominance, because that's what it's been. Some of the top players that have come out of the Columbia area in recent years have been a part of this tournament. It's more than just that. The Metro City Classic is a showcase. It is an event. It is someplace where we're highlighting the middle school athletes, because everybody talks about high school, college, but what about before they get to that level? So what we're doing is we're featuring some of that best talent, preparing you for who's next up. So I ain't going to talk too long at all. We're just going to get right into the footage, sit back and enjoy it. Metro City Classic. I'll come back at the end and give you a recap about it. All right? Sit tight.
That's good, so it shows it was good. Shows that it was good. Hospitality room on point. You see how it is. It's how we treat people at the Metro City Classic hospitality room. This is the first middle school game of the tournament. Next up, we've got E.L. Wright taking on Cardinal Newman in game number 3 to close out our night here. East Point and William J. Clark battling for it right now. Pauling, nice job, Sully Pauling. DJ Mack on the ones and twos, 10th annual Metro City Classic, A Decade of Dominance. I run you over like a truck and leave you dead in the street. You're inviting me a type to a battle. Why? I don't need your respect. I got it made. I'm talented. Yes, I'm gifted. Sugar Eaton. He says, I'm talented. And yes, I'm gifted too. 3, 2, 1. From D. Just off the mark, Chad Key. Great contested. To fulfill my needs, got first half. In the sand of the West Indies. Even got a little island on my very own. I got a frog, a dog with a solid gold bone. And you know what it is? The 10th annual. Chad Key drives. Nice step through, Mr. Chad Key. Carmelo Ellerby on the drive. Floater. Short. Ian Goss cleans it up. Yes, sir. Ian Goss. Four and a half to go in quarter number 4. This is just game 2 of 4. Today's action at the Metro City Classic. Timeout taken. Full timeout taken by Heathwood Hall. DJ Mack, it's your time.
Clark, you guys had an outstanding season. We appreciate you coming up here and putting it all on the line, working with us. It's been a pleasure watching you play. Come on out here, ladies, the coach. William J. Clark is coached by Coach Scriven and Coach Jackson. You guys did an outstanding job. First, we want to thank Sam's Club as one of our major sponsors this weekend. we had a great room in the back for coaches and for VIPs, and you got a chance to really see how it feels to live on the other side. We appreciate that. We have a GM from the store in Forest Drive, Forest Drive location. Make sure you guys go out there and check them out. 2024 Metro City Classic Champions, Southern Parkway and Eagles.
Number 11, Isaiah Dunlap. And rounding out their starting five, number 15, Latrell Christian. Starters have been announced. The two contestants are at center court to jump ball. Good job, little dude. My man got a whole routine. You better knock it down. There you go. Yes, sir. About to say, you got a routine, you better be good, bro. Oh, rims out. Give another crack at it. Get in there. Yes, Sirski. All right, 2-point game. Robinson gets the steal and lays it in to tie the ball game. Dawson. That aggressive defense played off by Kavion Dawson.
You guys had an outstanding history at our event. Three-time champions. And we appreciate you guys and everything you do. Let's give it up for Southern Parkway. Let's give it up for Southern Parkway and support them no matter what. All right, we got a few awards to give out. He's coming to you. And for Summit is Dunlap, player of the game. All right, once again, we have another award here.
Good job, Isaiah.
Now we have Coach Smith, and we want to also.
Yes, sir.
We really appreciate you coming back to middle school and supporting these young gentlemen on your quest to the next level.
Yeah, John.
Thank you very much. Let's give it up to Southern Parkway. All right, let's give it up for the Sprinkle Team.
Kennedy leads 15 points.
All right.
Christian gets it. He's gone the other way. Zion Jones back. Oh, Christian powers it home and lets Zion know about it. Dribble handoff, Jenkins thought about it. Gives it up, RJ, interior pass, Zion Jones. Good job, big to big passing. Moving without the ball. Sharing the ball. A lot of good things in that possession. A little bit too soon. Let's see, can Kyrie get one? Yes, he does. Kyrie, why? Get on that rim, young fella. We see you. RJ Davis. Yes, sir. RJ Davis.
Told you, man. That's why I said I wasn't gonna talk to introduce this segment too much. I was gonna let the footage speak for itself. As you can see, the Metro City Classic delivered on everything that I told you in the introduction, man. High level competition, great games, great players on display. You see, we had a seventh grader get on that rim. We had an eighth grader get on the rim. We had over overtime game and the boys' championship game, another good game in the girls' championship game. We had a player in the JV game. Chad Key dropped 51 points. That's a record. I mean, phenomenal. And like I said, we've had some of the best, you know, players come out of the metro area. That's what we call Columbia, the metro. And a lot of great players come out of the metro, come through that Metro City Classic as well. Do your research and look it up. Columbia basketball has been providing, you know, Division I overseas. I think the leading scorer in the country is from right here in Columbia. So, again, look it up, man. We got ballers here. And the Metro City Classic does a great job of featuring that next level or the next new class of ball players, male and female. That's what makes our tournament a lot different than others. You know, I say ours. I'm affiliated with it just because I'm the official PA announcer. But, you know, just to pull the curtain back even more, the director of the tournament is a homeboy, a friend of mine, also from Buffalo. Tell you them Buffalo kids, we be moving, man. But, you know, I actually didn't know him back home. We found out, you know, we know a lot of the same people because, you know, we Buffalo, East Side, you know, Hood Cats, whatever. We know a lot of the same people. We didn't quite know each other like that back home. But then we got down here, Columbia linked up. Like I said, I call him my brother. His son, Yale, is star point guard at Ridgeview, state champion this year. Shout out. Call him nephew. You know what I'm saying? That's family. But he does a great job of running that tournament every year. So give Coach Davis, Coach Ra, a shout out. He runs the basketball program over at Clear Dot Charter School currently. So, again, shout out to Metro City Classic. Follow the Metro City Classic. Make sure you are following me, of course, Coach Terry 803. I'm going to follow you back. I'm going to take a quick break. I need to refill my water. This is water, y'all. Refill my water. I'm going to get back. We're going to close this thing on up. Piano just dropped. Boom. Okay, here we go. We're going to close it out like this. We're going to recap this NFL season. Man, oh man, it was a wild one. I know. Before you can say it, Coach, you say it was going to be the Bills versus the Eagles in the Super Bowl. Okay, well, obviously I was wrong, all right? The Eagles got knocked out first round by Baker and the boys, and my Bills, once again, peed the bed against Magic Patty and the Kansas City Chiefs. Oh my god. All right. So I gotta wear that, right? I gotta own that. I'm not running from that. Yeah, that was my call. But listen, I told you I made that way back in September. A lot of things could happen. And technically my pick still could have been alive. They just gagged in the playoffs. But let's look back at the season real quick though. So the Chiefs did not look like contenders for most of the season, right? They were pretty much average. They was mid. They was mild during the whole season. And then, as I call him Magic Patty, I got that from my man Rock. But Magic Patty does what he does, man. He shows up when the lights are the brightest, brighter than my ring light in the background. I don't know, man. Some guys just have that ability. That's what I try to tell y'all about Jordan. Like, it's not about, like, when y'all try to debate and say LeBron is the GOAT versus Jordan, like, it's not about even the 6-0 in the finals versus 4-6, which is crazy. I don't know how somebody who lost more finals than they won will be a GOAT. But we gonna save that for another segment on another show. I'm just saying, like, when the light shined the brightest, Jordan always delivered. And that's what it is about Patrick Mahomes. Like, you could never count him out with bums. I'm not going to call them bums because they're in the league. But you know what I'm saying? Like, comparatively speaking, like, relatively mid receivers, like, he won a Super Bowl with Travis Kelce on one leg, basically. Like, it's crazy. Yes, the defense was outstanding, but I really thought, you know, the Ravens, because, like I said, when I made my picks on episode 6, I talked about how I thought the Ravens would take it. You know, Ravens and Bills would get there, and then I thought the 49ers and the Eagles were going to meet up. Okay, so that didn't work. 49ers did make it to the Super Bowl. Once again, I think that Brock Purdy is a good quarterback. I just don't know that he's special. And I think in order, in today's NFL, you have to have a special guy back there behind center if you want to win that chip. Because he's going to have to make plays. He's playing against elite defenses. I mean, for goodness sakes, you got defensive ends, you know, 6'3", 250, you know, running 4'5". So you got to have a playmaker back there, quarterback. That's what I was trying to tell Coach Chad at episode 5, when he was like, he wants a pocket guy that can just stand back there and sling it. If you look at Mahomes' best throws, they're made, a lot of them inside, most of them are outside of the pocket, the special plays, right? Anybody can stand back there. Jared Goff showed you that. He got a team to the NFC Championship, you know, and he even had a lead. But when things went off script and he had to make plays, and he couldn't do that. And so in today's NFL, you need a guy who can make plays and who can play a little bit off script. And it's really showing up more and more why the quarterback gets paid and gets treated the way that he does, because he's such an integral, college word, part of team successes. I still don't put wins and losses on the quarterback. I think that's whack, because there's a lot of other factors that play into that. Like when you say, like when they give quarterbacks win and loss records, I think that's disrespectful to the other 52 men on that team, because they have a big part to play in that win or that loss as well. You're saying defense doesn't matter, special team doesn't matter. All that stuff matters. The coaching decisions matter, like all that stuff matters. So I never say, you know, oh, he won or they, I don't do quarterback wins and quarterback losses. Like it's a team game. So I'm going to treat it as such. But again, the NFL season, you know, C.J. Stroud looked really, really good in Houston. Shout out to him. Shout out to D'Amico Ryans. Check out my YouTube shorts. I did a couple of shorts on the black coaching hiring cycle after the season ended. And then I did another short on how black quarterbacks were showing that they can ball in today's NFL and in the playoffs, which is a look back at episode 5 with Coach Chad, where we did a full segment on the black quarterback in today's NFL, and even the past, and just NFL in general, the state of the black quarterback. So it was good to see a lot of black QBs shining and ultimately winning another Super Bowl. Patrick Mahomes is black. I know they try to, you know, they don't focus on that because he's, you know, he's light-skinned and he's got the mixed, you know, parenting and his hair and stuff like that. But no, Patrick Mahomes is black. All right. So let's, yeah. Shout out to you, Patty. all right, so let's go ahead and the Super Bowl. So the Super Bowl was really good. I had personally a lot of money on the Super Bowl. I mentioned it before. I'm not ashamed to admit it. I am a gambler. I don't gamble more than I can afford to lose. I also do a lot of time, put a lot of time and research into my bets as well. So I had the Chiefs plus 2. I had the Chiefs plus 2.5. I had the Chiefs plus 1. I had the Chiefs plus 1.5. Also had the under. The under was really, really shaky when they went to overtime. I was like, no. But it worked out. Like, I just hit on the under. So if you're a gambling person, you know what I'm talking about. So the Super Bowl was pretty good to me on that front. Again, I refuse to bet against Patrick Mahomes. I mean, as a Bills fan, you know, he kicks our teeth in no matter what the situation is. We had him in Buffalo this year. We had him down. Like, we had everything going our way. The touchback through the end zone and just all kind of crazy junk. And just, listen, I'm never going to bet against that dude. Especially when you give me points. Never. So I learned that lesson because I took some L's this season betting against him when he was getting points as a dog. So, learned my lesson on that. But Super Bowl worked out kind of how I thought. I figured it would be a close game, and with that, you always take the points if you think it's going to be a close game. I thought the Chiefs would actually win outright, so I had the Chiefs on the money line as well, and that paid, that cashed. So again, Super Bowl was lucrative for me, and once the Bills lost, I didn't really care who won or lost. Looking ahead to 2025, at the time of recording, free agency has just started yet. We've had a lot of big trades and moves going on. I really don't like to gauge that too much. There's always a lot of hype about these big free agent moves and will it work, won't it work? I don't know. Who knows at this point, right? Because there's still a lot of pieces that have to fall into place. You still have those June 1st cuts. You have training camp casualties. You have a lot of different things that are going to come into play and the factor of how rosters shape out when they kick off that first week in September. So you also have the draft coming up. People make moves at the draft. So I can't really give you too many thoughts on that right now. I will like to say, I'll just say quickly, today Aaron Donald retired. Shout out to him. Being a defensive line coach for the last 8 seasons in high school, I can really appreciate what he did. The way that he took on double teams, the way he pushes the pocket from the middle. Quarterbacks don't like pressure right up the middle. They prefer pressure on the edge because then they can just step up in the pocket. They work on that footwork all the time. But when you push that pocket up the middle, now they have to roll out, get off their throwing platform, especially if it's a right-handed quarterback. He doesn't want to roll left and try to throw back. That's tough. It's just, again, he does a lot of defensive tackles, do a lot of underrated things. You can't just look at sack numbers. You can't look at tackle numbers for DTs. Are they eating up double teams? Are they playing one gap or two tech techniques? Are they playing, are they playing the slant? Are they playing the one? Are they playing the zero? You have to look at a lot of different things to determine the effectiveness of an interior defensive lineman. But Aaron Donald was such a freak because he still gave you the sack numbers. He still gave you the TFL numbers that were eye-popping for any defensive lineman. Then when you look at the fact that he gets double-teamed, triple-teamed on a constant basis on the interior line, it's so easy for a center and a guard to double-team a nose. And it's amazing. Shout out to you, AD99. I enjoy your retirement. 10 years in the league. What did they say? Nine times all pro, 3-time defensive player of the year. Shout out to him. Derrick Henry signing with the Ravens. I really like that move. I think that's going to be huge. I don't know who you focus on, King Henry or Lamar. I don't know. Shout out to Lamar for winning MVP. Again, so we had a black quarterback win MVP, black quarterback win the Super Bowl, and Super Bowl MVP. Please stop telling me we can't play. I do like that Caleb Williams will probably be number one. He's black as well. And now that his father is involved, they want to say, is he too involved? Like, oh, wait a minute now. Either black fathers are present, you know, or they're not. Like, don't say he's too involved. Like, it's just, anyway, they didn't say that when it was Archie Manning, though, and he was telling, you know, Eli, don't go to the Chargers. You know, you don't want to get drafted here. They didn't say that, you know, Archie Manning was too involved. Or when John Elway said, I don't want to go to the Baltimore Colts. I'll go play baseball, you know, unless I get to go to Denver. They didn't say that his father, Jack Elway, who was a coach, they didn't say he was too involved, did they? But when it's Caleb Williams, you know, when it's LeVar Ball, you know, when it's a black dad, then it's, oh, he's too involved. And it's, man, oh, man. I have so many thoughts, so many topics that I could touch on. Like, but we're going to get into these things and we're going to dive deeper into a lot of different issues. Like I said, it's not just a sports show. This is the Coach's Corner. This is your intersection of sports, special interest, and social commentary, all rolled into one, right? Trying to take you different places, merge those different places together to make it easily digestible for your brain. Enough of that, though. Just let's wrap up this segment by the NFL before I go off more and more on the tangent. But that's just how my brain works sometimes. I can start off going this way, then I'll go left, and I want to come back right. Then hold on, let's spin the block and come back. And so I have to keep myself. That's what you see me kind of glancing over here, my notes, like, all right, boom, get back on track, coach. Stay on task, coach. Stay focused. All right, I'm focused, man. The Bills, we took some losses, man, with Gabe Davis and letting Trey White. Yeah, he was a great player, but he's always hurt. So, number one, the best ability is availability. If you're not available, don't matter how good you are. You're serving us no good. Kind of sad to see him go, but kind of not. The Jordan Poyer releasing shocked me. But, again, I get it. Injury, and we can't pay too safe. You can't pay him and Micah Hyde. So we got to take a hit there. Drafted some young receivers, and I don't know. We'll see. Again, a lot of things have to work themselves out, shake themselves out. But, you know, I'm still here. Bills Mafia, we still here, you know. It is what it is, man. We used to, I told you, my 4 years of high school was the 4 years that the Bills lost the Super Bowl. The first year to the Giants, Scott Norwood missed that field goal wide right. That's why that field goal hurt us so much. Oh, and by the way, Tyler Bass. I saw you kick in high school. I coached against you. Tyler Bass is from the Columbia area. He went to Dutch Fort High School just outside of Columbia. Little town called Irmo, like literally right outside Columbia. Coached against him in high school. Great, amazing kicker in high school. Love the fact that a local kid was kicking for my favorite, my hometown team, but he choked it away. Missed that field goal at the end of the game. Oh, my gosh. That hurt so bad. Anyway, so that first Super Bowl he lost to the Giants, 2019, Scott Norwood missed a 47-yard field goal wide right. You can look that up. That next year, lost to the Redskins. It wasn't really that close. Then the next year, Cowboys. Then that next year to the Cowboys again, got the doors blown off, 52-17. And that was four straight Super Bowl losses. Never been done in NFL history. Probably never will be again. So Bills fans that are my age, you know, we're used to those heartbreaking losses like that, unfortunately. There's a song, it's called The Bills Make You Want to Shout. Matter of fact, I'm going to play a clip of it right now real quick.
The Bills make me want to shout. Kick your heels up and shout. Throw your hands up and shout. Throw your head back and shout. Come on now, the Bills are making it happen now. Stand up now, come on and shout.
So that's the theme song, right, for the Bills. For a good while, it was like an inside joke with Bills fans. They're like, the Bills make you want to pout. All right, that's it. I'm cutting this segment off, man. Oh, gosh. Heartbreaking 2024 season for any Buffalo Bills. Any fans outside of the Kansas City Chiefs, really. Especially the 49er fans. I know y'all thought y'all had it in the bag this year. You said, Brock is different. He's better than Jimmy G. Same outcome. Maybe it's your coach. Maybe he doesn't know how to coach in big games because he's always choking them down. All right, I'm out. We'll be back to wrap it up. Okay, y'all. We have come to the end of our time together for this episode. Episode numero 7-7. Man, oh man, 2024 is going to be a great year. Listen, I'm putting that out in the atmosphere. You put it out into your atmosphere. Think it, see it, live it, do it, be it, reflect it. Everything that you do, be great. Strive for greatness. Never settle for mediocrity. I have a slogan at my training company, Build a Better Athlete Training. Hard work plus dedication equals greatness. To me, that's the formula. If you work hard and you're dedicated at something, you'll be great. Like, that's just what it is, no matter what you're talking about in life. This is Coach Terry 803. Make sure you follow me. Once you do, I'll follow you. That's how it works. Make sure you install that Konnected TV app on your Fire TV, on your Roku too. Make sure you subscribe to the channel on YouTube. Like, comment, share the video. Listen, man, it costs you nothing to share a video. It costs you nothing to repost a post on X. I was about to say a tweet. Whatever it is, it costs you nothing to reshare the reel. It costs you nothing to tell a friend about the show. It costs you nothing to support somebody. All right? We got to do more of that. For real, for real, for real. Like, y'all will share posts of celebrities. Y'all will share posts of people that don't need the publicity, people that don't know you, people that won't thank you. But you have friends that run businesses that, you know, have, I don't want to even call them hustles, that have other streams of income that may be more of an independent base. And they maybe could use you sharing a video of theirs or telling a friend about their product or their service. I mean, it costs you nothing to do that. Anyway, we just have to get better at supporting our own, man. Like, that's real talk. We say it, but it's time to take action, man. Like, 2024 is not about talking, it's about actions. This is the Coach's Corner. We here on Konnected TV, we here on YouTube. I hope you've enjoyed this episode. Changing up the format a little bit for you, because I want to dig more. Instead of giving you more segments, I want to give you more in-depth information and different perspectives of each segment. So you're going to see a lot more things like interviews, a lot more behind the scenes, a lot more going places and giving you footage and things like that. I listen to you. I'm taking the feedback and email me, kkonktv@gmail.com. If you got feedback, comments, criticism, praise, love, hate, don't matter. I'm here for it all. All right. Again, shout out to the Metro Commandos. If you want to please support, donate, hit that Cash App. Metro Commandos. We are a 501c3 nonprofit organization. Everything you donate, you can write up on your taxes. I'll write you a receipt. Your Cash App receipt can serve as that same thing. You can file it on your taxes. I promise you. You show us love, we'll show you love back. Put you as a sponsor on our website. Follow us on all social media at Metro Commandos. Man, oh man. I just want to thank everybody for supporting the movement, for supporting the show. Shout out to the CEO of Konnected, Kevin Glover. Shout out to IM Energy Sports for the dope gear. Make sure you check them out. IM Energy Sports, my homeboy Fareed, doing this thing out there in the A. DL Wood for the beat. I'm just trying to thank everybody, man, and make sure that we all get our proper due. Because listen, this is a podcast. I sit here and I talk to you, but it's only about the things that you want to hear about, want to know about. Thank you for supporting the Coach's Corner. I'll catch you at episode 8.